Everybody, it's me, Undead Viking. I'm here to review another game for you. The game I'm going to show you today is called Friends and Foes. This game is by William Judd. I think it's his very first design, so to speak. Friends and Foes, in at its heart, is a tactics game. I've been playing a lot of these lately, like little skirmish tactics games. I don't know, and they've been hitting on all cylinders for me as well. I've been enjoying them. There's something so wonderful about actually, like, just fighting somebody, you know, but not having to play some big, long, epic game, which is what this is. It is a very fast, very quickly paced, one versus one, or two versus two, or three versus three combat game, which, technically, I think these games are made for playing with two players, not four, but two players, and, the rules do state that you can play with teams, so you can have, like, three people on one side, three people on the other, and you can be working together and like, you know, deciding who you're going to attack and do whatever. But, I mean, at its heart, I think this game works best with two players. At least, in my mind, I like being able to, like, program my choices and my commands and what have you, and not having to try to deal with and trying to convince somebody else to do something besides what I'm, want them to do. If that makes sense. But why don't I show you how to play? It won't take very long. It has a great mechanism that uses a deck of cards that I'm going to show you that I really found to be a lot of fun, mostly because of the probability aspect of it. And then we'll come back here and I'll tell you exactly what I think of Friends and Foes. All right, cool. Here we go. This is the game board for Friends and Foes, and at its heart, this is a two-player game. It is one side versus the other, though there is nothing that prevents you from playing like two people on a team, or three people on one team and one person on the other, or whoever you want to roll and play the game. I have played the game one versus one, and two versus two, and even three versus three, and in all cases, it plays virtually the same. I am going to show you, like, just one player versus one player with one character each. The only thing you have to keep in mind is that when you are playing with a team, that each of the sides has their turn and then the other person goes. So, and then the team itself, that when they go on their turn, they decide amongst themselves which character will go before which character. And so then one character gets done with their entire turn, and then they hand off to the other person, and so on and so forth, to complete the turn that you're doing. So, I'm doing a two-player game. Now, normally, I've set it both on this side just for ease of use to show this to you. Normally, one of these decks would be over here, though I have the health marker over here on the 30 for the Enforcer that is technically, theoretically, being played over there. And then we have the Fire Archer with his 24 hit points, and those are listed on the actual cards. Like, here's, like, the Fire Archer, which says he has a health of 24, and here's the Enforcer that has a health of 30, as you can see. And also, you can see the Enforcer has a power right on there. That he says, when you take damage, reveal three rune cards. And you can see there's a little symbol there, and you can prevent the damage. And that's the basic mechanic of this game. You will be moving your characters, and you can see there's these tokens, the Fire Archer and the Enforcer right there. You will be moving them on this board, trying to take out the other person. This is basically a battle skirmish game. And you do that by selecting a power in your deck of cards that you have an ability of. And you get more than just these seven, but you only get to take seven. So you have to pick what you have available to you. And so you take one of these cards and you'll play it. And everybody picks their card at the same time. That's also another distinction. You can't react to what the other person does. And that also goes for, like, if you have a team. Like, if you had a three-person team versus a three-person team, all of you would pick all of your card, the one card you're going to play, and you'd put it face down and you'd play that. Cards themselves have lots of information on here. You can see move of 0, basically says the character won't be able to move this turn when they do that. Range, it'll show if it's a range attack. It'll show how far away they can do it. This figure up here is the number amount of focus that it costs to actually use the ability. Focus is just being represented by these green cubes, and green and blue. I have some blue cubes up there. Obviously, you can't see them actually, but when you collect more, because like this one would cost 3, but you have certain abilities like Steel Trap that would actually you'll gain you back focus, because that's the only way you can get focus back is by actually using the different abilities to actually gain it back. And so it's part of the whole tactics of this game. This game is combat without dice, which is something that I like, and I'll talk about more in my conclusion, because of the fact that you have to actually plan several moves ahead of time, like think about what you're going to do. And having knowledge of what the other person has as far as their abilities go, like this their deck as far as their abilities, helps out a lot as well. And you don't ever use these up. When you play one, and then you take that action, you take it back and put it into your hand as soon as you're done. So it isn't situation where you're going to run out of them, if you will. Anywho, so you'll pick a card and you'll put it face down, and then you'll turn it over and you'll do it. And at the beginning of the game, you determine the initiative just randomly. One person gets initiative, and then it goes back and forth. So in this case, the Fire Archer is going to go first. Next round, the Enforcer will go first, and it'll go back and forth like that until the end of the game comes. The end of the game comes after you've inflicted the number of wounds that it takes to defeat them. In this case, there's this marker here, 1 versus 1, so it's one character versus one character. You have to inflict 2 wounds. Now you're saying, well, that doesn't seem too tough. Well, a wound is actually when you knock their health all the way down to 0. That's a wound. And so then it goes back up to 24, and you have to do it again. You do spillover damage. So, like, if you were at a 4 and you did 8 points of damage to the Fire Archer, you'd actually go to 24 and go back down to 20, but there'd be a wound in that case. This game does not take a long time to play, even with 3 versus 3. The damage and the attacks come pretty quickly, and it doesn't last all that long. It's like around a 20-30 minute game, I found, which is just, like, hits perfectly for this type of game. But I'm talking about my conclusion here, so I'm getting ahead of myself. But you might be wondering what these little cubes are in here. These are randomly placed on these spots here. And I should mention, this is a prototype. This is, like, I don't know exactly what this is going to look like in the published version. That goes without saying. But when your character does move on to one of these locations, they do get to take the cube, and you keep that, and you can use it at any point. You can use it that turn, you can use it in later turns. And what it does is it represents a rune power of that color that you can use at any time, and when you're going to do your abilities. Now, I mentioned a little bit ago when I was talking about this power the Enforcer had, that the main mechanism of this game is your rune cards. You're going to get 3 rune cards of each color, and you can see the colors are actually represented right here. So you get 21 cards, and you're going to shuffle them up, and they're going to be randomly in this stack. And so, for example, let's say my first action or whatever, like that my character did, and I turn it over because we're starting right where we are. You know, we're that close. You know, technically, I guess the archer would want to stay back, but in this case, I'm just doing him a little closer so he'd be able to do this attack. He's going to reveal this, and it's going to say it's a fire arrow. So the first thing you do is you get +1 focus. So you're going to take a gem and put it in your focus pile. So now you have an extra focus, and you're going to see that it says 4 here. Now that 4 tells you how many of your rune cards you're going to draw. And what you're going to do is you're going to hope that you draw one of these fire results. Because if you get a fire result, you're going to do what the thing tells you. In this case, it does 12 points of damage. And so you do that, you pick that, you show that ability, that's what you're doing, and then you turn the cards over. And this isn't like a deck building thing, because you don't really get to add cards. The only card you ever get to add is if you level up, and that's a special ability one of your cards will give you. And you just get one of these cards that's Enlightened. And you add this card to when you level up, and you reveal that card, it counts as one rune of your choice. But as far as like getting more cards in your hand, there's a big stack of these, because basically you can play with lots of different people and have big, you know, everybody's got to have a deck of these. But you don't ever get more. So we're going to take 4 cards, and we're going to hope that we pull off and get a fire result. So, right away at the very beginning, we got a fire. So then we get rid of the other 4. Now, but this is where the game kind of comes in, because at the beginning of the game, you have to actually decide, are you going to let people look through their discard deck so they can see what the probability of getting another one of these fire cards is? Or is it just you got to remember? Now, I'm horrible at remembering cards and horrible at remembering numbers, so I always vote for having an open deck. My opponents don't always go for that. But so you put those in your discard, like so, and I've succeeded. So that means I'm going to do 12 points of damage to the Enforcer, because they're within range of 4. And I should mention, also, that we should look and see it has a move of 0, so my Archer can't move at all. But remember, the Enforcer has the ability that if they draw the Sun result, they will avoid all damage, and they can draw 3 cards off the top of their deck, and if they can, because of their heavy armor, if they can pull off getting a Sun result, they're going to avoid all damage. So we have... Unfortunately, no. We have 2 purple and a red, so that isn't going to do anything. That goes in the discard, and so we start off by doing a big whopping 12 points of damage, dropping them down to 18. And now, even though I didn't pick a card, and I should have, I do apologize for that, we now will reveal the card that the other person has, and so we're going to reveal that they have a Zealous Charge in this case. And if you'll notice... that the Zealous Charge has a minus 1, so they're going to spend 1 of their focus. And you'll also notice that it has not going to be able to reach it because he's too far away. So he's going to be able to move 2. So we're going to move the Enforcer 2. And they're going to collect that green cube because of the fact that now they're going to have that available to them if they ever need to have a green result. And they're going to reveal 4 cards. Now, we're not going to be able to do anything. The plus 3 damage and knockdown isn't going to work because of the fact that, you know, we just can't actually reach him because of its range of 1. But we're still going to reveal those cards. And so we can also then, once again, have some sort of knowledge about the probability. And so we're going to go ahead and turn 4 over. And if we had been close, we would have actually gotten the damage and the knockdown. If a person's knocked down, you just flip their card over like that and it says knocked down, and that means they can't move the next turn. So there we go. That's the entire turn. We've had 1 person get hurt, 1 person hasn't, and so now we've flipped the initiative over to the next person. Both people are going to look at their abilities, and they're going to try to see what they're going to do. Well, obviously, the Enforcer is going to want to get close to the Archer, and they're going to want to go ahead and do damage. But we got to also take into effect that we only have 2 of those left. And so as long as we're getting close, I mean, we have these really cool abilities like Execute that, you know, would do 6 damage, but if we reveal the blue, we do enough damage to wound your foe, which is huge, but it costs 3 focus. So we don't have that. But now that we're close, let's see if we can get close and do this. Now, let's go ahead and get a plus 1, and the burst damage you can see there, that would actually affect... people burst 2, that's actually an area effect, so you actually, but we're only fighting 1, so that's not necessary. And some of these things, it's like, look at the top 3 cards, your rune deck, and discard 2 of them, that allow you to kind of build up what you want, and then you can also combo. If you can have this card combo with another attack, then you can do more damage. But we're gonna go ahead and I think I'm actually going, I want to try to do damage, so I'm gonna go ahead and use the spin attack. And so we reveal the spin attack. We're going to move 1. And we're going to reveal. And we get plus 1 focus back. So we're going to go ahead and do that. And we're going to go ahead and take 4 cards. We're going to hope we get a blue. Because we're going to do 4 damage to the Archer if we get that. And so, well, of course not. It's just not the Enforcer's day. They didn't get lucky. And so they didn't. Now, admittedly, the Archer, technically... shouldn't have been able to look at his stuff or whatever and do this. But let's just go ahead. And the Archer is a little worried because they don't want to be close to the Enforcer. Once they get close, that's when they start losing. So we're going to go ahead and get tricky here. And we're going to go strafe because... it's a ranged attack. We get to move 2, which is the big deal. If we can get a fire, we probably won't get it. We can do range 6, but notice you can take an extra turn if we get a purple. So we're going to go ahead and reveal 4. Now this costs us 3, which might hurt us a little bit in the end, but we're going to go 1, 2, 3, 4. We're going to see if we get a purple or a fire. Well, we actually got the last fire. Remember, we used up two of them already, which is actually pretty cool. But we're not going to get to take the extra turn, which isn't so great. So we're going to do 12 damage. Now, technically, we first we're going to move two. So we're going to go... let's go over here and pick up this blue rune. But now the knight, or the enforcer, I should say, gets to do their draw three cards and see if they can avoid the 12 damage. We did not get our sun result, so we're going to go ahead and take another 12 down to 6. And this is where initiative really comes in handy. So now we have a situation now where the initiative goes back to their player. The enforcer's on getting kind of the bad end of the stick here, but now they're close enough. If they can just keep the person at bay, where you know they might have a good shot at this. But we only have one focus left as the archer, and so we're gonna have to kind of look here. And we're going to go ahead and let's see if we can get him, take him down. We're going to go ahead and do this. It's going to give us plus hunter shot, plus one focus. Can't move, which might come back and bite us, but we're going to do, if we do it, we kill 9 damage and plus one focus if we get a bleed result on there. So we get plus one focus back, like so. We'll go 1, 2, 3, 4. We're looking for a red result. Oh, the archer's luck finally ran out. Look at all three purples right in a row. That's unfortunate. So the knight breathes a sigh of relief. The knight is going, or the enforcer, I should say. They are going to look for whatever their most damaging attack is. They've got all three of their back, and so we can do, and we can maybe we'll try to pull off an execute and see if we can pull this off. So we're going to spend all three of our focus, which is probably not the best idea, but I'm just doing this to kind of show you maybe like a last gasp effort. And so we're going to play that. That'll be our card. And we need a blue result. Now, I forget how many blue. This is why it's good to like check. So, okay, there's still a blue card in there. So I'm going to turn over 4 and 2, 3, 4. Now, what are the chances the blue result is still in there? Well, first of all, we're going to do 6 damage automatically. So we're going to knock them down to 18. So we're going to hope. Let's just do it one at a time and see what we get here. Green. 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 Oh! if I was the enforcer, I would be cursing my luck right now. There's the blue. It's on the very end. So we did 6 damage. We're going to move 1. We're going to... Wait a minute. Actually, I just forgot totally. We have the blue cube. So we're going to go ahead and... Wait a minute. No, I apologize. They did not get the blue cube. The actual person, they got the blue cube. So I apologize. They can't do that. I totally forgot about that ability. But we're going to go ahead and do 6 damage, and we're right next to them. And so that's kind of like the ebb and flow of the... Well, let's just say, for example, I did get that blue cube. So you can spend that blue cube and actually then immediately enact the execute ability, which would do enough damage to knock him down to 0, and he'd go from here to here on their wound. And so we kind of, and that's how quickly like the tide of battle can shift. And you can see why this game, you know, with two players is actually over pretty quickly. And with, you know, teams still could be over pretty quickly, especially if one team like loses one, then of course then three people can gang up. But I've had some pretty epic comebacks with some awesome combos and some card play with certain teams to pull out a win. But let me talk more about all of that in my conclusion, and I'll do that right now. Hey, I mentioned that whole probability thing in both how I was showing you how to play the game and also in my introduction. So let me just expand on that, which is the part of the game that I probably like the most. Once you become acquainted with all the different characters and all the different abilities, the game actually kind of opens itself up to you. I've used the terminology of like peeling the onion, if you will, in many reviews. And this is one of those games that it's so wonderful because you actually learn how to play the game really, really quickly. And after you've got that, and after you're really well acquainted with all the different powers of all the different heroes that you'll be using, I think the game comes with 7 or 8, and I think with the Kickstarter they're doing, they're looking at adding more or what have you. But regardless, you know, they have a certain number of abilities, and so you can only take 7 of those cards, and so you can't use all of them. But, well, I guess there's one called the Duelist that allows you to take 8. But, for the most part, everybody's got 7 abilities available to them. And this game, I think, works best when it's all open information. Like, let me see the powers that you took for your character. Okay, cool, I know what you can do. But then I have to keep that in mind, because I do like the process of putting the card down and then revealing it. I think that's that kind of weird, rethinking of what the person's going to do and what abilities they have at you. And I do like the fact that you don't use those abilities up. It isn't like a fire and forget kind of action where you place the card down and then you go ahead and that can never be used again for the rest of the game. And so you have that. I like the fact that there is the whole process of keeping the focus, and like that your little expandable and collapsible resource that you have to kind of keep an ebb and flow of. And I think that all ties in really well to the whole tactics part of this game. Now, I mean, I remember once somebody actually trying to explain to me, they said, what's the difference between strategy and tactics? And I said, well, and if I use this game to explain, strategy is figuring out which card you're going to play that you're going to chain to the next card, which you're going to chain to the next card, or which card you're going to play that's going to chain and combine with the person next to you, it's going to be next to you, and like looking forward ahead of the game, like what are we going to do next round, what are we going to do to be able to keep ourselves running and you know, be successful. Tactics is the actual like moving the things on the board and getting within range so you can use your powers and use your abilities. And there's a part of the game I didn't show you, actually, I feel bad about it, but there's all kinds of things, like there's certain abilities that allow you to trap people. Like they have these little tokens you can put traps down, and like the fire archer, and you may have seen these tokens, wonder what he has a ability that he's able to like basically set fire to an area on the board for it lasts a round or two, and that does damage to anybody that gets close, friend or foe, if you will. And so there's a lot more going on, including, and also there's like there's a barbarian, of course, that like when he takes damage he can rage, but also he's got an axe that he can throw that literally like he throws it and he has to go pick it up, you know. So I mean there's all these other things that go on and little nuances that I apologize I probably couldn't show you, but I didn't want to have a huge long explanation as far as the gameplay goes. But I do say that the designer himself has a very good overview of the gameplay as well, that he has on his Kickstarter page, so you can go ahead and check that out. Why do I dig the game? I guess I've been really liking these skirmish games because of the fact, like I said, it condenses an epic battle that tells a story and that's a lot of fun, and in a short period of time. I can play this game in about 15-20 minutes with somebody, and this is like one of those perfect games to play when I don't have a lot of time to game, but I just want to goof around and play something, and the focus isn't going to be all about the game. It's just kind of fun to play. I like the whole process of moving on the board, and I like the whole the activity of it, if you will. I like the spatial aspect and like I said, the kind of like the story that the game shows me. I love the whole probability. As I said, I like playing with knowing what cards are going to discard. Yes, my cat made it. I love knowing what cards are coming or what my chances are. Like I showed you, like in the gameplay, I showed you the whole process of where the I had 6 cards left, and I got to drew 4, and I knew that there was one blue card within those 6 cards, and if I could get that, I got to pull off a really powerful ability. Well, I love that. I love, like, okay, I got a 66% chance. Now, by doing that, I've used up all my focus and everything like that, but I'm gambling that I'm going to be able to pull that off. I love that aspect of the game, and I love the whole process of, what do? Do I pull it off? Do I get it? Did I get it? Ah! Or yay! And that's that whole process of the game that I really enjoy. And I really, I mean, and I'm sure there's been a game that's used this kind of card draw mechanism for combat before. And I'm sure it isn't like completely new, but for me, it was like a really fresh take on the combat for me. I without having to deal with like dice for combat, because and I think using dice for the randomness is a wonderful thing for lots of games, but for this one it wouldn't, because of the fact that I think this game, the charm of this game lies in its quick and fast action. And you need to have the deterministic process of combat for this game to be fun. And it is a heck of a lot of fun. So, there you go. So, is it a game for you? Well, if you like card-driven war games, I guess maybe this would be something that you'd be interested in if you're looking for something that's kind of light. If you like tactical skirmish games, I think it's definitely something you're going to want to check out. And especially if you like fantasy themes, because there is a very nice storyline fantasy theme about, like, the whole runes of power and everything like that that this game is based upon. That it really, the characters themselves expand on it as well, very well. So, go ahead, check out the game. Check out the other characters. I mean, the assassin. Check out the assassin. The assassin's got some awesome powers with, like, being able to stab people and put poison that'll affect later on in combat and things like that. Stuff like that that's just really, really, you know, makes the game pop. And then, like, the different characters really show up. And I really like playing the barbarian as well with the whole rage ability. But, and there's, you know, like I said, there's a lot of different other characters and abilities that I think you should go ahead and check those out. But if you have any questions about the game, please ask. I'll be happy to answer those to the best of my ability. As always, thank you very much for taking the time to watch this video. And in the meantime, until the next time we meet with one of these videos, try to have yourself one heck of an awesome day. All right. Well, say goodbye, Lily. She doesn't feel like saying goodbye. All right. Take it easy.